This symposium, Contemporary Conservation Practice, is essentially about sharing and transferring knowledge, science base, and technologies relating to environment and biodiversity, its values, functioning, status, and trends, and the consequences of its loss. It's about exploring conservation issues together. Conservation issues of concern, it aims to impact policy, enhance conservation efforts, motivate action, promote partnerships and collaboration between authorities, practitioners, and stakeholders, and to address contemporary challenges facing conservation of biodiversity. A highlight has been that a few review papers were presented, for example, on bush encroachment in Southern Africa, and a global review on marine biodiversity and marine protected area targets. Such papers are significantly valuable in guiding the way forward, and so I hope that we will hear more such review papers at future symposiums. The poster session, although small, with 9 posters, was of much interest and value to inform us about studies in their initial stages. Access to information and the use of newly developed technologies, for example, telemetry, camera traps, computer programs, smartphones, is essential in identifying threats to biodiversity in wildlife crime law enforcement and in determining priorities for conservation and sustainable use. You need also to question old and conventional practices. The symposium is also about encouraging research and research into new or previously neglected fields, the development or advancement of the natural sciences, as well as new technologies and improved monitoring. Knowledge that is already available here in South Africa is usually buried in the dusty corridors of departments, scientific institutions, and universities. Access needs to be improved. Possibly, SANBI may take on an additional role of becoming a clearinghouse of biodiversity information. Nevertheless, the message is clear. Firstly, biodiversity and conservation knowledge is a prerequisite for evidence-based decision-making. And secondly, all of us must make even greater efforts at multiple scales to improve and grow biodiversity change, ecosystem services, and impacts on human well-being. It was stated that conservation practitioners had not yet given enough attention to creating wildlife business models. Exploring and developing a philosophy around a green economy, for example, by harnessing biodiversity capital to reduce poverty and inequality through an inclusive economy whilst protecting landscapes and ecosystems. You are encouraged and maybe even obligated to leave behind that legacy. The model or design used for the symposium has, in my view, been very successful. Plenary sessions where several papers were presented that set the scene for the sessions that followed that day, and the value and importance of discussion periods that followed. The structure used for discussion sessions, in particular the KZN Rivers Source to Seas, evidence-based conservation, and the session on stewardship, were particularly valuable and could be copied for discussion sessions on various other matters at future symposiums. What I particularly appreciate was that groups were asked, 1, what are the lessons learnt? 2, what should be our vision for the next 10 years? And 3, how do we get there? My task was to consider and synthesize 176 papers, 9 posters, 29 discussion sessions, delivered in 5 plenary and 35 theme sessions over 5 days. The impossibility for anyone to be at 4 different venues at the same time, and to now have to talk for 30 minutes, draw out the key messages, issues, trends and progress, leave me overwhelmed. You'll agree, not an enviable task. But in keeping with Jean and her organizing committee's cosmic expectations, that someone had to do that. So who better than a retired wrinkly and crumbly? So if I say something that is not scientific, or just plain gobbledygook, you will detect a cause-effect relationship. So I apologize now for such demeanors. Also, I cannot be comprehensive and please everyone. I can only use what I have observed. And in our handouts of abstracts, thank the chairs of the various sessions who gave me their key message that arose from those presentations and the discussions I've had with many of you. So here goes. What were the most frequent messages arising from the symposium? Partnerships. By that we mean joint interests or associations with complementary skills, knowledge, and experience to achieve more. Partnerships should be multidisciplinary, made absolutely necessary, or even vital in all our conservation programs. For example, in law enforcement, stewardship, private sector involvement, or engagement with other governed agencies, harness the multi-skills, common interests, leadership, in order to fight wildlife crime, secure critical wetland ecosystems and water-producing areas. Research partnerships were strongly advised to undertake continuous process evaluation, that is, evaluation, reflection, learning, and adaptation. Coordination. Teams should have a secretariat with a coordination function that supports and works with the leader. A key message from the Nutcracker Lady was for authorities to strengthen coordination, collaboration, and coordination in the issuing of permits between provincial and national departments. The lack of adequate coordination was a matter particularly highlighted in the session on estuaries. Unfortunately, a way forward on who and can it be done remained unresolved. Target setting was seen as a social process. The advice was let biodiversity drive, but social interests have to be considered and taken into account. Biological science has a role to play in the formulation of principles, policies, laws, and regulations, elements fundamental to good governance and decision-making and for holding them accountable. Some of the major barriers to informing conservation policy, practice, and decision-making are the applicability and relevance of research findings. Reliable evidence may be limited. Poor communication by scientists, capacity within scientific institutions, the stronger influence of politics, economics, and social factors, and the unwillingness to change by practitioners. Importance of long-term data sets derived from rigorous conducting of long-term monitoring programs and of monitoring indicators. For example, monitoring to determine if movement is going in the direction towards meeting a biodiversity target, or fire monitoring and research for updating fire management plans, taking into consideration vegetation structure and the effects on herbivores. but also for providing essential technical information to not only support conclusions and recommendations, but also informing decision makers on critical biodiversity issues. But use what evidence is available still remains key. One has a far better chance or a much reduced risk of being unsuccessful if conclusions and recommendations sent to decision makers arise and are unanimously supported by a multidisciplinary group of partners, and especially if communication has taken place at all levels, that is, between and within management and research agencies, or other officials and politicians in government structures. We were told that invasive alien species was now regarded and acknowledged as the biggest threat to biodiversity. Generally, we recognize that invasive alien species are a major threat to biodiversity and ecosystem services, and that this threat is likely to increase. Although we may regard African ecosystems to be complex, we cannot assume that such ecological complexity would reduce their stability and allow for species loss or species invasions. Research is needed to identify those characteristics within ecosystem that may enhance stability and increase its strength, thus dampening the effects or impacts of disturbances such as alien species invasion, and therefore making extinctions less likely. Given the uncertainty about ecosystem stability in resisting invasions and species loss, and the multiple alien species, and that multiple alien species are already present and active, we have to prioritize control and eradication efforts on those species which have the greatest impact on biodiversity and/or which are the most resource effective to address. However, we do not have all the data on which alien invasive species pose the greatest threat, or explicitly the nature of that threat. Which indigenous species or ecosystems are the most vulnerable? What the pathway of invasion is, or just how ecosystem services are being affected? Importantly, indicators are lacking. Alien plant strategies differ between SADC countries, and there's a little coordination in developing strategies and or implementing control. Important lack of information sharing and control in a neighboring country has transboundary implications. Coordination, planning, prioritization, sharing expertise, and use of biocontrol agents needs to be a concerted SADC protocol, which must be prioritized and developed urgently. The challenge is to get government to take alien species invasion seriously, given its impact on the economy, industries, livelihood, health, and biodiversity. A notable success has been the clearing of Cremolina in Shishlu-Mfolozi Park, given its strong links to job creation, monitoring, and research. The Etekweni Invasive Alien Plant Working for Ecosystems Partnership Program is particularly innovative and a successful model that needs to be duplicated ad infinitum in South Africa, given its strong focus on skills and business development, with 8 SME businesses having been established. That is linking poverty alleviation, biodiversity management, and protection, resulting in a sustainable outcome. Research can make a significant contribution in presenting government decision makers with the technical facts. For environment conservation agencies, early detection, including disease, is critical and cost effective before such invasions become out of hand. Examples of process indicators are invasive species policies, strategies and action plans. We welcome the fact that the prevention and control of invasive alien species regulations 2014 are at hand and will hopefully go a long way in making a significant impact on this major threat to the country's biodiversity. Outcome indicators are trends in alien species invasion, status of invasions, and ecological impacts of invasive alien species. I suggest that a much greater effort by conservation scientists is required in the field in order to guide conservation management, especially inside protected areas. And where particular species have a severe impact on health and livelihoods of affected people and communities. The rate of habitat loss and transformation continues to be unacceptably high. The keynote paper by Professor O'Connor on bush encroachment and the papers on global change, vegetation management, use of fire as a management tool, ecological processes, and the session on stewardship, marine as well as rivers, source to sea sessions of particular note. Habitat loss, including degradation, for example, through bush encroachment and fragmentation, is one of the most important factors driving biodiversity loss. Demographic, economic, and social pressures will continue to drive habitat loss, degradation, fragmentation, and land use change. Our challenge is to substantially reduce the rate. For some ecosystems, it may be possible to bring the rate of habitat loss down to close to zero. For others, a more realistic goal is needed. Significantly, reducing habitat degradation and fragmentation is required in order to ensure that those habitats remain capable of supporting biodiversity. We are warned of the risk of continually implementing fixed fire regimes without assessing possible impacts on biodiversity elements. As practitioners may become the cause of some of the species extinction if we do not take care. The progress and achievements of biodiversity stewardship programs must be commended, given the following indicators. The total number of proclaimed stewardship sites in South Africa has resulted in a total area of about 400,980 hectares. The area awaiting proclamation is 541,980 hectares. The totals secured, for example, in KZN are 30 new nature reserves, 6 protected environments, an area of 103,700 hectares. We need to know if all these hectares are being well managed. The emphasis of this conservation land use program has been on preventing the loss of high biodiversity value habitats, such as those that contain threatened, endangered species and habitats, and on endemic species. Examples are the 4,600 hectares or so of Oribi habitat, 30,000 hectares for black rhino, nearly 8,000 hectares for wattle crane, and 2,000 hectares for blue swallow. The strategy has been to avoid passing the tipping point towards a decline to extinction, but also to improve ecosystem connectivity, representativity, and management effectiveness. However, if the stewardship programs are to achieve their species conservation objectives, ecological research must, as a priority, focus on developing a knowledge and understanding of the ecological networks within a broad spatial framework of ecological corridors, stepping stones, protected areas, species movement and migration patterns. Importantly, stewardship has evolved and thankfully has been standardized across all 9 provinces. For stewardship to be successful, the value of partnerships was emphasized. That is, robust linkages between government, NGOs, intergovernment bodies, private and communal landowners. Secondly, Stuart has allowed and facilitated conservation agencies to effectively and efficiently respond to the need to expand protected areas for the protection of critical biodiversity elements in the country. A key message for promotion, rollout, and acceptance of stewardship was to link this program to its impacts on the conservation of natural resources on one hand, to benefits to people, and particularly to align the program to government's political priorities. That is, those government priorities that address the socio-economic needs of people and communities. One last point on stewardship. What is particularly commendable in stewardship programs has been an exceptional, possibly unique innovation. That is, for government conservation authorities to partner with NGOs, private and communal landowners, in conserving the country's biodiversity. I've been a frequent and regular visitor to protected areas both within South Africa and elsewhere in Southern Africa, such as the Kruger National Park and the Zululand Reserves, for almost 60 years. In the 1970s and early 1980s, together with my colleague then, Tony Waitley, we carried heavy concrete blocks into the bush at many sites where these were permanently marked and the state of vegetation photographically recorded. In the last few years, I have been fortunate enough to revisit these sites with Tony in Shishluya and Mfulozi, and in Chitala with Chris Barachivi. A comparison of the vegetation habitats then and now showed vegetation changes in a 40-45 year period that are astounding. The rate of habitat conversion inside our protected areas is therefore a growing concern and may explain why so many species have become extinct, or nearly so. For example, in Shishluya Mfolozi Park, Southern Reedbuck, Steenbuck, Klipspringer, African Marsh Harrier, White-Headed Vulture, Brown-Headed Parrot, all of which were regularly seen, although some in small numbers, when I was stationed there, are now no longer to be found. Given this scenario, it is essential and a priority that a strategic plan be compiled by conservation planning managers, ecologists, to address this threat inside the protected areas, which in my view is as serious as the alien invasives are to the persistence of biodiversity, for which reason and purpose the protected area was proclaimed in the first place. The possible extinction of threatened species continues to be an ongoing matter of concern and will remain so for many decades to come. Several sessions focused on this concern, such as the species conservation, approaches to conserving invertebrates, amphibians, and wildlife trade. Extinction can't go backwards. So the challenge has been to find ways and or actions to reduce the threat of human-induced extinctions, to improve the conservation status of threatened species, and to address the indirect and direct drivers of change. For example, by protecting sites where such threatened species are located, researching ecological networks to determine where their vulnerability lies, combating particular threats, such as over-harvesting of fish resources, or a disregard for environmental conservation laws given traditional cultural rights in rural areas, and implementation of species recovery programs. In previous symposiums, we stated that the rate of biodiversity loss in South Africa is alarming and must be halted. It is not being halted, and the loss is still alarming. Despite all our efforts, the progress has been made in the last year, and that is encouraging. Last year, the urgency for South Africa to be ready with the Rhino Horn trade proposal at CITES Conference of Parties was stated. Disappointingly, the department and minister let, in my view, the country down. The government was not ready. Will government be ready for 2016 CITES Conference of Parties? One remains somewhat sceptical and strategically cannot take the risk in pursuing a policy of demand reduction for rhino horn while slaughter of the species continues at an exponential growth rate. And without sufficient evidence that such a policy would be successful, given firstly the time it would take, that is, in the shark fin example, by saying the same thing for a long time. And secondly, that 1 million Chinese would have to change their behavior in a population of 1.3 billion people, that is 0.01%. Unrealistic. Game-changing interventions, such as disruption of organized crime, together with improved governance, particularly in Mozambique, greater social benefits and sharing these with people in need. Poaching of rhino also threatens the survival of the private sector participation in biodiversity conservation. What has been particularly noteworthy at this symposium, which we may not have heard much about past symposiums, were the sessions on invertebrates and amphibians. These sessions were highly appreciated and welcomed. The session on invertebrates was particularly invaluable in highlighting taxonomic issues. All of us make the mistake of incorrectly identifying a species. This is a common trap with invertebrates, not only for those recording an observation made before history, but also for expert professional taxonomists. This session made several recommendations. One, use DNA barcoding in taxonomy. Not a single gene, but rather a suite of genes must be used to describe and identify species, such as the Diptera. The need for researchers to network amongst themselves for identification of species and conservation planning for the statutory protection of invertebrates. That future conservation in practice symposiums include a session on invertebrate conservation with ecological role and delivery of ecosystem goods and services. The session revealed that there are several databases on invertebrates relevant to conservation which have rarely been used. Access and use of these data in conservation planning is long overdue and must now be taken into account, and all conservation plans need to be informed by input of these data. A starting point is simply to compile a checklist of those invertebrate species and their conservation status occurring in each protected area. All the presenters are hereby encouraged by us to continue with the very important research work and conservation actions on these animal groups. The session on amphibians was also informative in emphasizing how important it is to fully understand all aspects of the niche of a species, its integrity, viability, biology, ecology, persistence, threats and resilience, and so on. The challenge was all about communication between professionals, general public, education institutions, and others. Blood horn, blood ivory. The matter of wildlife trade presents a number of dilemmas. On the one hand, commercial over-exportation of high-value species versus sustainable use, the international monopolistic illegal trade in threatened species or their products versus a regulated legal trade, the risk of reducing demand to levels where a species is worthless, has no or very little value to society, just like the international drug trade. The world's governments appear powerless to regulate and stop this trade by criminals that is driving many of these species to extinction. No. I do want to say something about conservation planning. About people, communities, biodiversity conservation. In preparing this document, I had no time in which I could take all these notes and see just how long it would take. Okay. But I see that it's almost lunchtime. So maybe I should rather end off. You're happy. But maybe others have a different view, but I'm not going to take a vote on it. Is there no support or support for that recommendation? Is there or is there not?
How many pages are left?
Well, I told you. How many pages? One. Three. You're happy? Thanks for your vote. Okay. Finding what is still out there, this is about conservation planning. Finding what is still out there and producing a map, yes, a very important and essential tool, is a gap analysis necessary? Should we be doing social assessments given that this is our biggest gap? If Mandy is unable to explain the cone of uncertainty, how can some of the rest of us, with our Pleistocene brains, handle it? Importantly, conservation planning needs to explore, develop an understanding of green economics. Not sure what that means and how it would differ from resource economics, but certainly economics has been a significant component that has not been sufficiently taken into account in conservation planning for biodiversity conservation. The progress made in marine conservation in the last year or so has been particularly noteworthy, with the directive that the economic potential of South Africa's oceans must be unlocked. The small team of marine conservationists involved in the Pakisa initiative faced up to the pressures and challenges and are to be acknowledged and congratulated in the identification of 21 new marine protected areas. And when these are proclaimed, will bring the target for marine protected areas currently at 0.4% to 5 to 7%. Etakrini Metro has shown the way as a local authority and is an example to all other metros and municipalities in the country by engaging with systematic conservation planning at the scale of the property owner. They have considerable challenges to meet and need collaboration with partners if within these urban landscapes critical biodiversity is to be protected and ecosystem service provision areas are to be sustained within the city. Are biodiversity strategic action plans for each province going to be developed? And with the resources, personnel and budget, what will be required for it to be implemented? That is, the design, needs, priorities and opportunities. Alignment with other government plans and implemented. At what scale? And what processes of stakeholder consultation and adoption? What indicators would be monitored in order to assess if such a plan is effective in safeguarding biodiversity? Plans for safeguarding, rehabilitating, and restoring the green infrastructure to strategically secure ecosystem services function, and the sustained production and delivery of goods and services to essential as essential interventions, not only to reduce poverty, but also to ensure the welfare of the Southern African people. In particular, services related to the provision of water that are essential to human well-being, as well as those that contribute to health and livelihoods, needs to be identified and safeguarded. Plans would also ensure that consumption and the impact and use of natural resources are kept within safe ecological limits. However, it was noted that there may be too many plans, and given this situation, confusion reigns. Planners need to become familiar with the Spatial Data Information Act so as to provide advice on requests to answer questions that are asked, which plan must I use? We anticipate that when the long-awaited Spatial Planning and Land Use Act is law, there will be significant implications for securing biodiversity and a possible escalation in confusion. The ever-increasing demand for food and fibre has and continues to increase losses of biodiversity and ecosystem services. Management systems in agriculture, for example, sugar, maize, wheat, sunflower seed, beef and mutton production, pine and eucalyptus forest, need to be adapted and become more sustainable with regard to biodiversity. We note that criteria for sustainable forest management have been adopted and are being implemented, as well as their participation in the stewardship program is also welcomed. To ensure ecological sustainable industries, they will still have to continue to promote good agriculture and forestry practice. That is, a greater application of the ecosystem services approach in order to reduce or minimize adverse impacts on the environment. Better control, including efficiency in fertilizer use, can be used to bring nutrient levels down to a point where they avoid nutrification of surface and groundwater and salinization of soils, thus allowing for healthy ecosystem function and sustainable soil fertility and quality water. The use of certification and labeling systems and environmental indicators in agricultural land use practices and natural raw food production should, in my view, be promoted, adopted, and implemented nationwide. Labeling has been used in some instances, such as honey badger friendly honey, but much more is needed. People, communities, biodiversity conservation, and parks. The vulnerability of too many communities that depend on finite, over-harvested and or depleted natural resources for their survival and welfare is further reason why the green infrastructure needs to be rehabilitated. Official action is needed to restore a sustained supply of the goods and services on which all life depends and which is delivered by the natural environment. The damage to ecosystem services has therefore serious consequences for human well-being. Conservation agencies need to re-strategize, focusing on building awareness of this issue amongst traditional leaders, municipal councillors, provincial leaders and officials in local and provincial government. The many service delivery protests that continue to take place in our country is a manifestation of government's failure to implement the necessary alleviating actions. My view is that conservationists share this responsibility together with other government agencies. They should also be seen to be doing their bit in solving the problem. Targeting conservation messages at decision makers and our engagement in policy formulation must be strengthened by allocating resources and be guided by a strategic action plan. The insight from the paper on knowledge brokering to use information graphics rather than lengthy reports or executive summaries to inform decision makers has to be heeded by all of us. So, please be creative and use your imagination to construct such infographics. Accept this challenge and do it. Last year, we noted that our conservation messages were not getting through. Nevertheless, these circumstances have not changed. I suggest that a workshop dedicated to this critically important matter of resource allocation and compilation of a strategic action plan to inform decision makers on biodiversity conservation matters requires resolution. It is now more urgent than ever. I suggest a workshop should be arranged soonest on this matter. For your attention, Ian. In a discussion with Rob Fincham, we will propose to Jean that the 2012 Fernhill Declaration be looked at critically in the light of what has transpired since then and what we have learnt subsequently. It may be necessary to revise and update. That declaration should be inserted into our symposium book handout where it can be read and reread. We must thank the 11-member steering committee and 8-member organization committee for a job well done in preparing, organizing, and running this symposium. Some 422 delegates have attended from 180 organizations, up by 25% from last year, shows a growing interest in and relevance of the symposium on conservation practice. May it continue to be relevant and to strengthen. Also, the symposium was supported by a multidisciplinary conservation community, which also appears to be growing. It plays an important part in a Southern African context in disseminating annually progress made by its practitioners in the practice of science and conservation. It has been a wonderful symposium. For me, a very special and memorable one. The old man and his son both gave presentations. The outstanding presentations on such a wide range of topics by committed conservation practitioners over the last 5 days indicate that conservation science and practice is in good hands and remains in good hands in South Africa. Although we still have our conservation Everest to climb or our Antarctic race to finish, progress is encouraging and gives us hope for the future, provided you remain determined, stubborn, resilient, opportunistic, principled, and passionate. I wish you to travel back safely. Recall what you have learned here. Take the required actions. Make the necessary changes. Now go and get back to work.